Call this regular board meeting to order. Please rise and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right. Next up, we have the approval of the agenda.
I'll make a motion to approve the agenda.
Second.
Got a motion by Goodrow, a second by Carrero. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And those opposed? All right. Next up, we have public comments, and I don't believe there are any requests tonight for public comment. So we will move on to the consent agenda. The consent agenda is made up of routine business items that can be acted upon with one motion. If any board member wishes to discuss an item, they may request that it be pulled from the consent agenda and will be acted upon separately. Does anyone have an item they wish to discuss? Hearing nothing, I'll move to the approval.
I'll make a motion to approve the above consent agenda.
Second.
Got a motion by Carrero, a second by Doyle. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
And those opposed? All right. Now, we're going to move on to our work session discussion topics. First up, we have a ISD 917 update with Mr. John Christensen.
Chair Cordes, board members, thank you for the opportunity to be here tonight. Over the time that I've been at the intermediate, I've been to Farmington board meetings on a number of occasions, but as I look at your makeup, that's been a while since I've been here, and some of you have some background, and some of you heard parts of what we do in our work, but we wanted to kind of give you a good thorough overview tonight, and then also talk a little bit about the new case program, which was what we were here a year ago talking about for the addition to one of our buildings. First of all, I'd like to mention that one of our challenges as an intermediate school district is to explain to community members, our K-12 school district employees, our board members, our parents, our students, news media, and the public in general, what an intermediate school district 917 actually is. And in an effort to develop a clear identity, we've developed a short explanation built around our Minnesota school district number 917 or 917. So when someone asks you what it is that is this intermediate school district, you can tell them that the 9 stands for 9-member districts. And the way I remember the 9-member districts is I take a driving tour. I have this map in my head of how I get around the metro. And my driving tour starts in Bloomington. I go down to Burnsville, Savage, Eagan. I get on 13. I go over to West St. Paul, Eagan, Mendota Heights. I keep on going into South St. Paul. Then I come south to Invergrove Heights, on down to Hastings, come over and catch Randolph, come up through Farmington, and I stop over in Lakeville. 9 school districts, 9 members, mostly Dakota County. Now, the one in the 917 is we have one mission, really, which is to serve our member district students and families in the areas of special education, career and technical education, and alternative education. And then the 7 is, and this is really coincidental, we have 7 core organizational values. And our 7 core organizational values are passion for service, integrity, stewardship, equity, collaboration, open communication, and continuous improvement. So we're trying to get the 917 to be something that our employees and people that we work with, when somebody says, what's a 917, they can have something to kind of share with people that doesn't have to go into these long explanations. Now, having said that, I'm going to go into one of these long explanations. Sorry, you didn't get off the hook. The next page in my handout there that's either in your board book or in paper form at the table there, there are 4 intermediate districts in the metropolitan area. We are one of 4. This shows you the map. We're the green map. We're the green part on the map. Intermediate 288, which is newly formed and used to be the Carver-Scott Co-op and the Minnesota River Valley Co-op, is the purple districts to the left. The 287, which is as old as we are, which is up in the West Metro, is in the yellow. And then 916, which is the Northeast Metro, that's the fourth intermediate, 916. So those are all the districts across the metro that are represented or work with intermediate or work with schools as an intermediate district. Our programs, and I'm going to start with our special education programs, and I'm going to start first with what we call our federal setting four. These are public separate facilities that include children receiving special education related services for greater than 50% of their day. And in our case, almost every one of those students receives it for far more than that. They can be in the 70s to 80s to 90% of their day. And the sites that we have these setting four programs are at the Alliance Education Center, which is in Rosemount on Biscayne Avenue, just off of 42. Another setting four site is in Eagan, in a former Burnsville district on Diffley Avenue. And that's a Sun program there. And then our Lebanon Education Center, which is in Apple Valley off of Johnny Cake. Now, just backing up a little bit, the Alliance Center serves students that have needs in the EBD area, emotionally behaviorally disabled, and also students on the autism spectrum. The Cedar School serves students who have needs on the autism spectrum. And the Lebanon site serves both IDA or EBD students and then students that have needs in the mental health area, which we call our therapeutic education alternative. And these students all have diagnosed mental health situations or conditions. Next, we serve setting three students. And these are students that are receiving special education related services outside the regular classroom, but still spend a good portion of their day in a regular classroom. And we have a DASH program for severely handicapped students. And locations for the DASH program include Christy McAuliffe Elementary in Hastings, Hastings Middle School, Hastings High School, Henry Sibley High School, and Lakeville North High School. So there we partner with our member districts to provide that programming in their facilities and working with their faculty and integrating with their students. Next is our PACES program, which is a program for alternative communication, education, and socialization. These are kids, some of these kids also have an autism portion of their disability. And the sites that we have our PACES program are Cherry View Elementary in Lakeville, McGuire Middle Level in Lakeville, Lakeville North High School, Meadowview here in Farmington, Bachman Middle School here in Farmington, and Farmington High School. So that's one of the programs that we partner in the buildings with your district. The next is our TESA program. This is a transition education program for students 18 to 21, and it is located at Dakota County Technical College. And we share facilities there, and the students have classrooms there, as well as have the opportunity to interact in some of the activities in the building. Our Deaf and Hard of Hearing program has two locations, well, has several locations. The preschool is at Diamond Head Education Center in Burnsville, at Gideon Pond Elementary in Burnsville, has a site at Century Middle School in Lakeville, and a site at Lakeville North High School. And then the next setting three sites are our care and treatment programs. These are programs where we work with other entities and we provide the educational program while they may be providing some kind of service, whether it be chemical health or mental health treatments, or they might be at the juvenile services center. Some are in the full-time lockup facility and some are on a probationary status and come in for day programming with us. And then those locations are Anthony Lewis Center in Burnsville, the JSC in Hastings, a YTP program, which is a mental health program in Burnsville, and an options program in Burnsville. A little bit of how big, how many students, what do we serve? Our special education resource programs, the ones that I've talked about here, are about 525 in number, the number of students that we serve. Our special education purchase of services, where we sell and this always sounds interesting, we sell services, audiology, physical health and disabilities, physical therapy, vision, and related health services. We serve about 800 students with our purchase of service programs. And in our care and treatment programs, we serve about 175 students. The next slide is just the people that work in all, or our leadership team in our special education programs. Our director, Melissa Shaler, who's here tonight, and then the assistant directors that also work at the off-site locations as serving as an administrator, as well as many times a building level administrator. Other programs we have are the alternative learning centers. These are for students that are typically 16 years or older, up to age 21, who need to acquire credits and coursework in order to achieve their high school diploma. We have one alternative learning center at Dakota County Technical College, serve students there. And students there also from time to time are able to take college credit or college level courses since we're on that campus. And then we also have a alternative learning center located in the West St. Paul district that serves students in the west northern part of the intermediate district. Just one little aside, that program was birthed when Jay was still superintendent in West St. Paul, and we did a collaboration there at that time. Our secondary programs, besides the alternative learning schools, also have career and technical education programs, and these are for 11th and 12th graders. And these programs include computer technology careers such as Cisco Networking Academy, computer service and repair, graphic communications, video gaming. We also offer fundamental chef training, food industry careers, a medical careers program, transportation careers in auto and heavy duty truck, and we have a construction trades program also at that site at DCTC. And then the last two slides, which people are usually interested in, is how many students do we serve from a particular member district. The first slide is last October's numbers from our special education programs, and the Farmington district at that time we were serving about 209 students, from some in a setting four program to some at the programs housed in the individual district buildings. So that was special education. And then the career and tech portion of our operations, last year Farmington had about 103 students participating in the programming at Dakota County Technical College in our program. So Farmington's always been, if you look way back in the history, a good supporter and had a lot of students that have attended and been able to be involved in our programs, and we've always appreciated that. So I would turn it over to Melissa if she wants to add anything, or if you have any questions for me, and then I'm going to introduce Melissa to come up and talk a little bit about CASE, or I can have her do that first.
Any questions? Or Melissa, would you like to add anything?
It's funny, we're doing the Melissa's thing. I was like, are you talking to me? Or that happens at our meetings all the time. I'm like, wait, I don't have to talk anymore. You know, one thing I just wanted to speak to that you could help me with out, John, is one thing that's impressive to me is while these classrooms are can be difficult and challenging to work with, we have excellent longevity of our staff. Most of them stick around and work well with those kids and kind of have their calling, and they're working with these students. And having a child that's actually been in some of these programs, it's been great to have that experience.
We've been doing some looking at our employee demographics, and we've had, as I know you have had too, we've had a big challenge in acquiring staff in particular areas because of licensing needs and those types of things. But we've also had a lot of mobility in our non-licensed staff, and as we've looked at those demographics, it's interesting that if a person comes and is working with us for 5 years, they tend to stay. And then we have the veterans that are, in their 20, 25 year type employment. But we tend to then have that mobility in the first 5 years. And we're seeing more of that, particularly in our non-licensed staff.
Before we move on,
Yes.
Does everybody have their cell phones away from the board table?
That's just what I was stepping on. So anyway, that we are blessed with some very veteran and excellent staff in a lot of our areas, particularly our deaf and hard of hearing programs and our vision programs have some very long-term staff, very excellent staff. Melissa, why don't you come up and talk a little bit about our newest program?
Chairperson Cordes, board members. I just want to make one.
We've got a few little technical, new speakers in the space which are influencing our microphones.
We can tell.
It's
so loud.
You hear yourself loud and clear.
Yeah. I don't like it. Can't make any like smart remarks. Everyone will hear me. And it must have thematic touch.
Yeah.
Sorry for the interruption here.
Intermission for those watching at home.
Make yourself a bag of popcorn.
Sorry for the interruption.
Thank you.
Thanks, Andrew.
So just one point of clarification. John talked about the... My cell phone's in my purse. The 209 students that you have from Farmington last October that are being served in our programs. And that includes not only your students in our resource program, but your students that are being served through our purchase of service. So the students that are in your programs, in your schools, that our vision teachers are coming in and serving, deaf, hard of hearing, that sort of thing. So it's combined into one. So last August,
late August.
We were here to talk about funding for a program that we are starting. And I'm going to do this PowerPoint so you can see the construction project, and then maybe this will be solved by the time this is over. So this is just a pictorial. It's about 70 slides. They're timed, so it'll go fairly quickly. Just what that construction project was like for us at Alliance.
Yeah. Hey, try that, see.
Test all those. Just say test. Test.
I guess I have one quick question for you while we're kind of cognito here. Is how big of a staff do we have locally in Farmington for the 917?
That's a really good question. We have our staffing ratios for our PACES program are a teacher, 6 students, and 4 paraprofessionals per classroom. So I would do the math, 5 times 3, about 15 917 staff that are in our programs, and then, or in our programs that are located in your buildings. And then purchase of service is really dependent on what the students' needs are. We try to centralize so you would get, usually a teacher that's doing deaf and hard of hearing. When you're the size of Farmington, sometimes that's split into a couple of different teachers that serve that. We have one deaf and hard of hearing teacher in particular that is an expert in serving our birth through three population. And so that number varies year to year. It would be a handful, you know, between maybe 5 and 8 other staff. So
it was based on students coming in and, okay, thank you.
Yep. So that was just a little run through of what the construction was like. It started out a little rough and ended fairly smoothly for us. The addition to Alliance Education Center was intended for our CASE program, and our CASE program is the Customized Alternative Solutions for Education. And so the idea behind this program was to do planning and programming for our students that are not being successful in virtually any setting that they've been in. And so that includes our setting four programs, but it also includes residential treatment, day treatment, and some of those other things. And schools have to stand ready to serve, and so we heard from our member districts that they wanted us to create a program so these kids could be served as traditionally as possible. So we thought about what we needed to do in order to be successful with those students. And so we started meeting last, probably August, and really tried to articulate what we wanted that to be and how we wanted it to be different. And so the mission of the CASE program is to collaborate to wrap around students to provide customized solutions-oriented education in a safe, supportive environment. So I have just kind of a run through of what the CASE program is comprised of. It's a 10,000 square foot addition to our Alliance Education Center, and when it's at full capacity, it will house 18 students. Beginning this Wednesday, we will have 5 students enrolled, and right now I have staffing to serve 6 students. So I need another teacher before we can get more students. Right now, our plan for this year is a dean of students. We have a dean of students in place there. We would hope to add a teacher at least by December. Paraprofessionals, we have two, each student has 2 paraprofessionals. And then we have support staff. So we have a behavior support team per group, so per group of 6 students. That's an additional 2 paras to help respond to crisis and support staff as they're working with students. There's a board certified behavior analyst in place. We have a licensed independent clinical social worker there, meant to really work with families around that wraparound. Related services like speech and occupational therapy. And then there's, of course, administrative assistant and custodial services. We've done a different approach to training, really trying to think about positive impacts for kids. So thinking about things like mindfulness, nurtured heart, restorative practices, really working on teaming with the staff there and training them on how to work well together so that doesn't become a distraction in working with the students, and also trauma. Both primary trauma, how do we work with students who have experienced that, and then how do our staff deal with secondary trauma. And in terms of strategies for the program, there's just a few different approaches we're taking. The families do sign an agreement just because it's a little bit more intensive in terms of meeting times that they might be involved in. So we wanna be upfront with that right away. We have core team meetings where we sit down and really plan. It's kind of like having your IEP team gather between on a weekly to maybe every 3 weeks basis to track progress and talk about how students are doing and plan for what's going well and not going well. Wraparound meetings where we're inviting anyone who might be involved with that child, from county services to private providers, to really make sure that what we're doing educationally is working well with what all the other service providers have in place. And then our staff are meeting for daily classroom team meetings. So we've structured the day so that they have time to gather and our paraprofessionals can be part of that. And then we've also structured some staff support meetings as well into the day for them. So it's in the very beginning stages, but we spent a lot of time in the planning process. And so it seems like things are executing well at this point with the program. And we have a lot of students. We have 5 students this week that will be in program, and 2 of them are actually from the Farmington School District. And this isn't something Kim planned last year. These are both students that came to light in August. So maybe it wasn't part of the big plan, but we're certainly glad that we have a program that can serve them. So I'll entertain any questions.
Are there any questions or comments from the board?
I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Is this program meant for students to transition out of, or is it to follow them throughout their education?
Our goal with all of our programming is ultimately to transition students to their least restrictive environment. And the goal would always be that that be a environment that's not 917. But in this program, I think our students that are in this program will likely transition to another setting 4 and then maybe to a setting 3. But our goal would be that it's a highly individualized, structured environment. So our goal would be to introduce them to, and there isn't a lot of others. It's a pretty quiet, controlled environment. So the idea would be to introduce them initially probably into the Alliance environment with other students, and then beyond that, maybe back into a setting there. It really depends on where the students are at. Mm-hmm. It's really about coordinating those services for them. If we can coordinate them and they can all work well together, I think we can achieve that goal.
Thank you.
Any other questions?
I have a question, and maybe you already said this, so I apologize if you did. What are the ages that are in
this? I didn't say that, so this is a good question. We serve K-12 in the program, and because the students are individualized, so each student has their own, we call them offices, but they do have their own classroom, small classroom. We can serve that whole age range. And the way that the program is structured, we can arrange or assign students to those spaces so they are kind of divided by age level.
Mr. Chair,
yeah.
Just to add, that's like most of our other programs as well, correct? I mean, they're all K-12 based on need and which program best fits the student's need.
So Alliance Education Center has 17 classrooms, and the classrooms are generally, you know, it depends on who we have, what the makeup of the, but it's usually a primary elementary, intermediate elementary, middle school, and high school. Those are kind of the configurations. Occasionally we might have a 7th grader in with a 10th grader, depending on where they're at developmentally and what their needs are. Sometimes that's really not appropriate, and it might need to just be, say, juniors and seniors in a class. We really look at what the kids need, but we are serving K-12. In all of our setting 4 programs.
Any other questions?
Mr. Chair,
yeah.
I would just like to highlight one event that maybe John could speak more to that. First of all, it's really, I want to thank you for coming and giving this good overview. I know it's a lot. It's kind of alphabet soup completely on steroids because you have all these different programs, and when you kind of get these, like, there have been times like, what was the idea? What does that stand for? Like, I can tell you who goes there, but I can't tell you what it stands for, you know. But thank you for coming for the overview. The one piece is, it's great to hear the explanation and kind of see it on paper, but as you guys know, I like to actually go in the buildings. Like, for me, the boardwalk is where I kind of learn and experience and feel what it's like. And you're always welcome. I know John would take you, or I could come, or whatever, to visit any of the buildings and just kind of see how the programs work, because each of these programs are just so differently structured for the needs of those kids. And when you go into the building that has tea, where they have the therapist rooms and they have the mental health and the different pieces, how it all works, and it just kind of see the structure, helps you kind of wrap your brain around how it works for these kids that are attending the programs. And I know that I'll just do this preview, and John can speak more, but we're going to have an event on March 6th, right? The 6th, there will be a little bit more of that. Can you mention what that's all about? Kind of get on their calendars now.
Check the calendar for the 6th or the 8th. I don't remember which day.
Oh, the 8th, excuse me.
It
is the 8th.
I think it is the
8th. I wrote it down and said it wrong. It's Thursday, March 8th.
Years ago, we used to have an opportunity for all board members from all the member districts and all the superintendents to come and do some interaction with staff, take some tours of some of our sites, and get a good feel of what we were doing as intermediate. With busy schedules and boards getting to 2 and 3 board members a month and those kinds of things, we found that was a hard thing to expect of people to do that. But we're going to try it again this year, kind of resurrect it. It's set up for March 8th. It's going to be like a reception from 4 to 6, a little overview and presentation, and then we want people to be able to come, and we'll have small groups of people that will be able to interact and then walk you through the site at DCTC, and then at a designated time, we'll have transportation where we can go over to Alliance, run out to Lebanon, and if time allowed, maybe up to Cedar to see three of our setting four sites. So if you want to put it in your calendar now, that would be great, and we'll get more detail out as we kind of put the whole thing together. Kind of a little meet, greet, and a roadshow. So that's kind of what we're looking at. Anything else on that? And Melissa's invitation's always open. If you want to just contact our office through Julie, and she can get in touch with Linda or I. If you just have a half a day or some time and you want to set up a time to come do some visiting, we're more than happy to do that. Any time, anything that works into your schedules, we'll make arrangements for it. So appreciate your interest. And I, as Melissa says, sometimes the overviews and the slideshows are okay, but actually being out and seeing it in action gives you a much better sense for what the work is like.
Thank you, John. Thank you. Thank you, Melissa, for coming out tonight. It was a great presentation, and thank you to our Melissa for suggesting it.
Thank you.
All right, next up on our agenda is the first day of school and enrollment update with Superintendent Hogan.
All right, thank you. Chair Cordes, members of the school board, and our audience tonight. We always say, just quickly, talk about the enrollment numbers for the first day. Of course, there's big shifts that happen. So the big presentation you all look forward to see where we really are at, happens next month. But for now, I thought I'd give a quick update. And I did get around, as a few of you saw, to all of our schools on opening day. And managed to poke my head in about 400 classroom spaces, and you get a really cool sense about the year. And every year, just like every child is different, every classroom is different, every school year is different. And there was just, people were happy. Happiness was kind of the word this year. And I don't know what you all or anyone was in buildings, but it's it was a real happy, good start to the school year. So I'm excited for that. And so here's some of the numbers. Again, don't worry so much about them. We'll give a big report on them for our October 1 numbers. But I'll give you a sense. So Aiken Road last year had 650 students. This year we were predicting and budgeted for 640, came in at 634. So pretty close to what we budgeted. Farmington Elementary was 604 last year, forecast 602, came in at 586. So that's 16 lower than we had budgeted for. You know, not uncommon to have schools, be off in one direction or the other. Meadowview, last year 699, again we forecast 676, came in back at 697. So they kind of made up and more for the last two schools being a little bit under. And if you see a trend here, it's that we have smaller kindergarten classes right now, just the number of kids that are out there, a number that were born in certain years. And so then we end up predicting smaller sizes in every one of our elementaries because of that. North Trail, again, last year, 586, 584 predicted for this year and budgeted for, came in at 580. So, you know, that's really a wash. That's really very close. And Riverview predicted 792, last year was 810, came in at 784. So again, one that was a lower than predicted by about 18 students. Now, for our middle schools, Bachman was at 899 last year. We were predicting 925 growth. They have those large elementary classes are now moving into middle schools. They came in at 952. So budgeted for 925, and they came in at 952. So that was quite an increase. Where Dodge last year was 782. We're predicting 766 and came in at 749. So maybe the number to really highlight is 749, this is 952. We've talked about how there seems to be an imbalance really happening and actually pretty quickly between our middle schools. That's 200 students different, and really wasn't planned to be that way. It's just where people are moving to, where kids, where families are moving that have kids that age. It's quite a difference, and it's the reason we will in the near future have a presentation where we bring to you people, our officials from our communities, to talk about what they see for growth and talk about why some of that is happening. Our high school, last year's 2052, we were predicting up to 2105, came in at 2145. And so we're getting to be more and more one of the larger high schools, you know, in the state. So it's exciting to see. Gateway Academy, again, we don't have prior numbers because the Gateway Academy is now new. It's now really a middle school program. So we put a number on the line at 49. Actual opening date came in at 36 students. So, some final thoughts on our elementary schools are down from last year, about 70 students across the board, but only down about 13 students from what we predicted. So it was planned for. Middle schools we were predicted to be up 10, and they ended up being up 20 overall. And our high school, we were predicting to be up a little over 50, about 57. Came in almost 100 above what it was last year. So overall, we put it all together. The reason we keep track so much is first for staffing, and those are numbers that we've used. You kind of predict where it's going to be for staffing in each building. And we came in 24 over what we had budgeted to start the year, which is a really important number, because it's not uncommon to lose, 25 or 30 students by the time the October not one student count comes around. And that's, in the end, it's not that we get paid on that one, but that really more accurately reflects the kind of experience we're going to have for the school year. And again, our budgeting is due to the number of students. So being up 24, I think I had reported we were down almost that many when I was before you maybe 4 weeks ago. So it's good. It's really a good thing. Final thought, though, too, every year has its flavor as well, about hot spots, because hot spots are true things, anomalies that happen. And this year, even though we're only up those 24 students, we have 6 more teachers across the system than we had the year before. And at least 4 of those are just due to hot spots. It's just something that happened. And I would say more hot spots than we would expect. I don't expect that to happen next year. I expect next year to go back and we'll have students kind of like they are, more of an average kind of spread in number of hot spots. But that's something, if you remember, we took some from those funds we were setting aside, at the end of August to hire those staff. And again, next year I don't plan for that to happen. Wouldn't expect it to happen. Haven't ever seen that large a number in the past, but it did happen. But we feel really good about the way we are staffed now to begin the year. So that's what I have.
All right. Are there any questions for Superintendent Hogan on the numbers?
Mr. Chair?
Yep.
I have one question. What was the capacity planned for the high school? Do you remember what that was? This might be more when we get the October numbers, but I was just kind of thinking in my head.
Well, thank you, Member Saucer. I'm Chair Cordes. I've heard quite a number of things. In the end, we had those extra spaces in the school, and they told me that we could go up to 2,400 by getting staff out of their classrooms during their kind of prep periods and into those spaces in the building. That without doing that, as soon as we got much across 2,000, we were going to start having some space and crunch issues. And I'm sure the building's starting to feel pretty full. But I will say, again, I'll repeat something of all things that I think it was Lowell that said about 2 years ago at a board meeting, that the way we staff and the way we think about our schools now, that he threw out a number that he thinks we could have 3,500 kids, because, again, we don't think of it as getting kids, getting a lot of students in just these classrooms and bells and kids moving and then cramming in back into classrooms. We think of our whole building. We think of a different way to schedule. We think of kids, you know, at being more like a college campus or something, something where I think we can handle, especially as we become more and more flexible, a lot more students. So that's, I'll just say it's kind of one of the, kind of, I think, gifts to our community, this idea that we don't have to start talking about building additional high school, very expensive space, that we will use the way we schedule and use more of the day and more of the year as the future unfolds, so that we won't have to be, you know, spending, you know, many tens of millions of dollars to add on. So I don't see a time when we will ever come to you with a conversation about, you know, increasing our space for the high school. So,
thank you.
You're welcome.
Any other questions? We look forward to the October numbers.
Yep, always.
Next item on our agenda is a conversation on board meeting format. It was expressed several months ago that we might want to look at changing the way our work sessions are structured. And we did, as a board, make the decision to continue with recording them. And this is just a follow-up on that conversation. And when I sent out the note to everybody late last week, I had a couple of things to kind of think about and bounce around. You know, how do we record, whether that's audio or audio and visual? How do we display the meetings? Do we put them on YouTube, or do we have them available upon request? And then what kind of seating arrangement do we'd like to see? You know, something where we're sitting up here, administration's down there, the presenters are over there. Do we want to see everybody at a round table format? And before we have that conversation, I was doing some thinking about this weekend, and Jay and I had talked about it briefly, but a few weeks ago, Jay sent out a note indicating that we were purchasing live streaming video equipment. I'm sure everybody had a chance to read that note. And I thought, well, is there a way we can use this new equipment that we'll be purchasing to kill two birds with one stone, to record the meetings and to be able to sit in a round table format? And if this is something everybody agrees to, we can direct administration to look forward to see if this is truly an option. But can we move our work sessions out to the high school, use the large lecture, or not the large lecture hall?
Under the stairs.
Under the stairs. Is that the large lecture hall?
Okay.
The lecture hall. The regular sized lecture hall. Set up the live streaming equipment in that room. We can set up a round table for all the administrators, all the board members, guests that we may have. Be plenty of space for an audience to come and watch us. I think the only issue we would need to look into, and Jay, maybe two issues, was do we need to purchase any more microphones than had been planned? And would we be able to both live stream these meetings and post them onto YouTube? Which, I mean, I'm a novice when it comes to all that audiovisual stuff. I'd assume you could do both of them with the equipment, but again, that'd be something that the administration would have to look into. Again, this is just an idea, maybe a half-baked idea I came up with this weekend. I'm open for any other conversation, but I thought it'd be a nice way to kind of bridge all of the gaps and kind of come up with a package that might satisfy all of our desires on this change. We'll open it up to comments from anyone else. There's a lot of talking from me, I'm sorry.
I don't think that's a bad idea. I wouldn't have a problem having our meetings at the high school. I personally would like more of a, we all sit at the same level, round table kind of discussion. So that's the most important thing to me, whether it's just audio or video. I think audio would be fine as well, but if we have the live streaming capabilities, might as well do that anyway. But yeah, I definitely would like to change the format, and I think I made that known earlier too. Mm-hmm. So I'm up for this. So I say this because I typed up my notes, so that's all.
For the live streaming part of it, have we purchased all that yet? Okay. Because, I mean, I'd like to see it tested before we move forward with it. Because a lot of times it's that little slowness in it, kind of like the cube.
The buffering kind of.
The buffering part of it. That would be my only concern. I think it's a great idea to go down that path.
To live stream it or to record it?
To live stream it.
Okay.
So what? I think that's a good comment to make sure it works before we jump into the deep end. What's the anticipated timeline? Do you guys have one at this point?
At this point, I just know that we're in the process of ordering it. We don't have a specific timeline as to when all the equipment's going to be in, but we can get back to you on when the equipment's going to come in.
And I think if we decide to move in that direction, that would be part of the request we have of administration, was to test it before we go live. Mm-hmm. Are there any other thoughts or suggestions?
Mr. Chair, just to clarify, this live streaming equipment, will we be approving this as a board? Or is I'm trying to remember the details in the notes, and
I think this was under the threshold for the administration just to make that decision.
Okay.
And I wouldn't anticipate the microphones would, if we need additional microphones, that would bump it above that threshold. Mm. So I think that's an administrative decision.
I appreciate that the discussion has come back to this. It's taken a while to get here. I'm glad to see it back at the table after our decision to have the meetings going forward recorded. I think this would be a great way to make use of the equipment that we're going to have to use and still allow the community to come and see it and have both hopefully live and recorded meeting. I think that sounds like a great solution, especially if you're already getting the equipment.
Mm-hmm. I think the big part of it to me is that it can be used by all within the school district. Mm-hmm. It's not just for a school board meeting.
Oh, yeah.
It can be used for mm-hmm. a lot of different things.
Athletics, arts, graduation, name it. Plus the school board now, if we can use it in that capacity.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
We had talked about the main concern was like the additional cost of moving the meeting. If we purchase the live streaming, is there still going to be an additional cost for staff to organize all the files, whether it's audio or video or anything like that? Or is that not something that we need to be concerned with?
Well, this is what we wanted to know, is what is it that you want? What's your, you know, what is it you're asking? And then we would come back to you with that information.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So it sounds like, and Kristen, you speak up if.
No, I was just going to ask, I thought we were going to get a kind of a comprehensive, what would all the different options cost? And is there any savings from not doing this twice a month here at this location, or does that cost remain the same whether or not we're here once or twice? I feel like we need to have that information too to be able to kind of have a complete mm-hmm. discussion about it. But
so I think, I mean, if we all feel comfortable asking administration to pursue that information for the live streaming option, I think we can get that. Those figures, since we're, you know, deciding to move in one direction rather than having all these other options on the table.
So can I ask for clarification? So you're asking what is currently the cost to run our board meetings here versus what would be the cost if we went to this model right here that we're talking about with the live streaming, right?
Yeah, I mean, total cost of both would be helpful. Yeah. And I don't necessarily need to know, did we save here or there? I guess just knowing, is it going to add cost? And if so, how much?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. Mr. Chair, and just to clarify, part of that's the production piece as well. So from the meeting to the production, whatever audio, video, editing that they need to produce mm-hmm. it to get it up, correct? Is that what you're saying?
Just correct.
To yes. further clarify.
Staff time for the people in the booth. Mm-hmm. For lack of a better term, and then after the meeting to get everything uploaded, and mm-hmm. I think that's fair.
Can I also make a request that we get that information prior to whatever the next meeting is, that we discuss it so that we can look at it and actually vote on something, because mm-hmm. this has been a long process for this discussion, so that's what I would request.
I we'll direct administration to look into all of these questions, you know, whether it can be both live stream and posted to YouTube, which again I assume it can, but and then if there would be a need for additional microphones, and then what that comparison would be between this model and the proposed model. Are there any other requests?
Mr.
To see if it works.
I guess you may want to look at booking that, because I know that gets booked pretty quickly, the lecture hall down there, and space is a hot commodity.
Mr. Chair, to add on to that, if what we're asking for, your idea of using the live streaming, if for some reason, once the administration takes this and goes back and realizes, oh wait, we have this vision of how you describe and how we think it's going to work. If that's not going to translate to how it really can work for some reason, I'd appreciate options for similar, like this won't, or if this won't work, here's an option that would be comparable to what we're asking, but with whatever format that is, whether that's recording, what the other options are if this isn't going to work the way we're directing now. So when we come back and have this discussion the next time, we'll have everything at the table and we can make the decision and move forward. Because as Jack said, it's taken a while to get here.
Can I just ask another question then? So is your priority then to have the conversation? I heard you say, Member Doyle, that you would like to have the conversation around a table. That's kind of your priority. And then after that, it's, you know, the recording part of it.
For me, yes.
For you. So as a board, can you help me with the priority so that when we talk about what could happen and what couldn't, like what is it you're after? Is it that you're after that? What, Member Doyle, is that like part one and then the recording part doesn't matter? Or is there a certain, what can you tell me with that? Just so we have more clarification.
Mr. Chair, can I clarify before? I don't think she means like recording doesn't matter, but whether it's audio or video.
Got it.
Not that we're not doing it. Yeah, we're going to record it. It's just in which format. Yeah.
I think for me, I don't see myself moving forward with agreeing with something that's going to have additional cost because we already pay for this. We already have recorded meetings. We already have this format. I understand the value in sitting around a table. We've had discussions at this table about the fact that people aren't forthcoming when being recorded. So in my mind, I don't know what's really going to change in sitting around a table. I don't think it's a bad idea. But for me, a priority is I don't want to spend more money because it's not, I don't think that's necessary. That's just me personally, though.
Steve, do you have any thoughts about?
I mean, if I had to rank stuff, I think we do need it recorded, but either way, financially, I agree with you 100%. I mean, we have a nice setting here. Sitting at the same level, I think, is great, but is it a priority for me? No, I don't think it's going to change the conversation that much at the table, to your point, Kristen, on that. But again, I would like to spend money in other avenues if it was significant, you know, especially if enrollment's going up, to look at budgeting different stuff. I know we did a great job budgeting for teachers this past year. I would rather put money towards something of that caliber than putting something towards a meeting like that since we have this place.
Melissa, what are your thoughts?
I have to concur with what Kristen and Steve are saying. We have the space here. Maybe it's part if it is going to be a significant additional cost. I'd be willing to have some wiggle room with if it's a couple extra mics, you know, something like that. I think that's doable. But if it's a significant cost, I would like, once we see those numbers of how much it costs for this space and for the production and those comparisons and kind of see if it's something minor, I think I'd be okay with it. If it's largely significant to what we're doing now, the cost to change that format, I'm not sure I'd be in favor with that. But in terms of ranking, we've agreed it to be recorded, so it's easier to follow having the visual and the audio together. It's really hard to go on auto recording, especially if you're looking for certain discussion. It's more difficult to follow just from a community standpoint if we don't have all the modalities involved and just have one. Unless we have more detailed notes, and I don't want to ask Lori to do that right now, but if we were to change formats, we'd have to have some other way to allow the community to follow along, and honestly, for us to go back to meetings as well and find out what was going on. It's not just one piece is for the transparency to the community, but it's also for us to stay accountable with what we said, with discussions. We've gone back to discussions before, so there's more pieces to it. So, you know, preferred, yeah. All of it.
I guess.
But I guess one factor, I guess, to your point, Barb, is what is a significant cost?
Good question.
Now, a significant cost to me is $10,000 or more, personally, on that. I mean, even $5,000, there's other programs we can throw it out there at, too.
You're talking annually?
Yes. Yep. So I guess, you know, the rest of you would have to speak to that. I'm tight with a dollar on that, and I'd rather use it somewhere else, personally.
I agree completely.
And I don't want you to waste your time either, Barb, by doing all this research.
Yeah, I mean, if you know information that can even guide us in that, even before you do all that work.
I don't offhand, so this is why I'm asking all these questions. So now I heard Member Saucer say that she would prefer the video and audio, I mean, the video. Could I get a sense for you if that's, so for example, we don't want to ask our tech department to really look into all these different options with audio, if really it's video that you're after. If that truly is where you're going to land for this, it would be helpful to know up front. So do you have a sense for yourselves if that's important to you, or if audio really is, either way is fine for you? Just in case the live streaming doesn't work. So
I would think we need both, personally, because, I mean, good point. It's tough to follow just a recording on that. Or you look for something, because I go back to board meetings to listen to certain things on it.
I would agree. And I would feel like we're going backwards then, and I think that would be a little bit frustrating. But,
Mr. Chair, also just to have some historical perspective, when we met at Bachman Middle School at the little theater there, and we had work sessions, we would bring a table out, and the camera work, per se, the production quality wasn't as high as our regular meetings. I mean, there wasn't as much focusing on the individual speakers, but it was there, and that could be okay too. I'm not looking like Channel One News where we have everyone zoomed in every time they speak, but having that video. So I mean, there's qualities of production that don't have to be as high per se as maybe we have in this venue.
I would agree with that.
So audio and visual sounds like what we're after. Sounds like it'd be nice to sit at a round table format, but not a deal breaker.
I don't know, the way that we're discussing right now, why are we even thinking about changing it? That's kind of where I'm at. Like, we want this and this and this and this, so why even, that's where I'm at right now, why even change it? Like,
Mr. Chair, I guess that's a great point too. Again, I don't want to waste the administration's time, because there's more stuff that I think they can focus on than this meeting and trying to get all this stuff back to us. To make this work while we do have something already that exists. So I guess I would hate to waste your time on this, because just listening up here, there is going to be a cost to it. Mm-hmm. And I think realistically, when we're talking equipment like that, $10,000 is nothing. And I think your time is more valuable than changing everything up right now, personally, on that.
And Mr. Chair,
yeah.
There are ways, this has honestly been a great discussion tonight. And there are ways to have great discussions by facilitating it as chair to kind of keep things going, or as the superintendent, whoever's presenting, like Barb's been asking questions, that we can have this discussion and we can kind of forget that, unfortunately, we're a few feet taller than everybody, because I think we should be down on the ground with everybody, you know? We can have a discussion as long as everyone keeps having that discussion.
So, I mean, we can continue to explore this live streaming option if that's what the board would like.
I think it'd be a
nice use of that equipment.
Agreed.
I would say let's get it rolling first and then reevaluate the conversation. Let him roll it out, the live stream first, and just see the capabilities. Because again, I go back to, I do not want to waste the administration's time on something trying to get this up and running and going before the school district actually has it out there right now.
I think that makes sense, seeing as we already are purchasing some of the equipment, and just seeing how it works for some of the pre-approved, or approved is the wrong word, but pre-intended uses. And then, unfortunately, it's just going to be this conversation being dragged on a few more months. But if it does work for those uses, we can talk about it again. Otherwise, like has been said up here, we've got a perfectly good venue and recording equipment as is.
Mr. Chair, just to clarify, because we've kind of gone around this, what was the timeline for that equipment again? Sorry to go back, but
Yeah, like I stated earlier, the equipment has been ordered. We don't know the exact time, and we can get back to you about the time frame for it.
So it's already been ordered, so if we needed additional, it'd be an additional expense from what's already been ordered right now. So it wouldn't be part of the package deal that we just got or whatever. It'd be, is that correct?
I don't know all the exact details. My understanding is the equipment that we bought should get us head to toe what we need for streaming. I think, speaking from the gut, the additional cost would be microphones.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I guess, Mr. Chair, I guess I would recommend at this point, Barb, not to move forward on anything. Do your research. I would not recommend that now. I would say let's just move forward with the live streaming. It's already being purchased. And then once it gets purchased, we'll get feedback of how it's working and just reevaluate at that point is what I would say mm-hmm. at this point in time. Just so you're not wondering if we're saying go ahead and look at stuff. I'd rather you do something else than worry about this personally.
I think that's a fair assessment. We'll stick a pin in it at this point. We'll, if it works as it's intended to use, we can have this conversation again and see if that price point for the microphones is something we can look into in the future. Sound good?
Yep.
All right. Next up, our last work session discussion topic is graduation fees. Jane put together a couple of budgets for the 15, 16, 16, 17 graduations.
It's just 16, 17.
16, 17 is the one in board book. Mm-hmm. With the intent to have that conversation of whether or not we want to continue having the families impacted at graduation pay for the cost of graduation, or if we wanted to shift it to the school district covering the total budget. So, Jane, I'll throw it over to you if you want to bring up the budget you pulled together.
So what you have, Mr. Chair, board members, Superintendent Haugen, members of the community, what you have in front of you is just the representation of our graduation ceremony for the 16-17 school year. And I just put the two columns there because we did talk back in June about some of the expenditures. Some of them have come in actual. So I just wanted to make sure that we are showing you everything and what has differentiated from the conversation earlier. I really am not anticipating going into great detail. I think we put some explanation in here on the clarification of expenditures. Really, I think the bottom line is that when we have it outdoors, we do lose money on it. And so it's not like we do, and that the purpose of this is not to gain money, but to make sure that we're covering our costs. And you can see that we clearly don't cover our costs, and we are spending general fund dollars towards this program. So I'll take any questions people may have.
Mr. Chair, I have a question. So what year or how many more years do we have until we really can't have it in the gymnasium with the amount of students we have?
Well, I might bring Mr. Berg up, but before we do that, one of the great things is the reason that we bought the streaming technology is for that purpose. You know, so we do know we have our larger class sizes coming up, and I did take a look at where we're sitting today, and currently at the high school, our largest grade is in ninth grade. Our smallest, of course, is our seniors, and we do take a jump. Our seniors are at 455, and our 11th graders are sitting at 544. So we'll have a big jump there, and we should have the streaming technology under our belt. Will that mean they'll be limited to how many people physically get in the gym? Probably, but you still will be able to see the ceremony via TV streaming somewhere.
So I think that'll be one of the big issues is how many actual tickets will people be getting to actually physically see it than streaming it. Because my personal opinion is I would not want to see it streamed if I was a family member flying from out of town. Even though I think that's a great opportunity, I'd want to see it live personally on that. I think people would have concerns about that. I think it's a great venue to look at doing that. But I think people would be a little upset about that as well, because you would have to reduce the number of tickets you get for the auditorium to actually physically see it.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Chair, yep. To your point, Steve, though, I talked to quite a few parents and families that were at this graduation ceremony, and there was so many people there already that they couldn't see anything. Like, they could hear it, but they couldn't actually see who was walking across the stage or anything like that. So I think streaming is a good option, and for a lot of people, sitting in the auditorium might be a better seat than if they were outside on the field.
Yeah, I again, we had a lot of people after graduation this year that would have were fortunate enough to sit and see it, and I think, again, from this past year, if that was inside, in, we would have some issues with some families on that. But streaming is a great opportunity. I'm not saying it's not, but I'm just saying I think, you know, it's a happy juggling act, too.
Any other questions or comments towards the discussion of the fee?
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
So today I met with Superintendent Haugen about, like, the agenda, and I saw that we were going over graduation fees. So as, like, the student member, I went on Twitter to get, like, feedback from my peers. Most of the people that replied to my tweet were already people that had graduated, had paid the fees, and they voiced their concerns and opinions to me. And I think the biggest concern that was raised was that the way we phrase the fee is a lot of the seniors last year thought that they were paying for their diploma. I think if we reword it the way that we're giving this fee as maybe a ceremony fee instead of graduation fee, people would be more willing to pay the fee and not have so much against the fee. So that's what I heard from my peers.
I like calling it a ceremony fee or something along those lines, because that is really what it is. When you look down at the budget.
So yeah, that was the biggest concern, was just that multiple people said they worked 13 years to get this diploma and then they had to pay for it. And then explaining to them that they were paying for the ceremony versus the diploma, they weren't as angry as they were in spring when they found out they had to pay the fee. So I think if we just figure out a way to reword it and explain to the community and the students and the families that they're not paying for the diploma itself, they're paying for the ceremony, that I think a lot of people will be more willing to pay.
Thank you. Any other thoughts?
Mr. Chair.
Yeah.
I appreciate you forwarding back these details. I do have a few questions on some of the line items. In regards to the total amount spent for staff and custodial, can you explain how that works a little bit more? Are staff, is it like a stipend to help out that night, or how does that work with the staff?
Yeah, for the actual ceremony for the additional staff, they do get paid for those additional duties above and beyond their normal day. So that is part of what is included in there. And the custodial, so in a normal business world, you have cost centers, right? And you charge off custodial staff or project management staff to different projects. In the public sector, we don't do that so much. So this, when we estimated the custodial time that was spent on graduation, it was very minimal. I was very conservative. I'm going to tell you, the custodian time that was spent on graduation is a lot higher than what I included in on here. But I took the conservative end because that's what we do in the public sector. You take the conservative end for it. So it's the staff for the actual graduation ceremony. They don't get paid for the rehearsal, so it's managing the students through graduation as the administration is running around and making sure all the final details are done and everything's going to go off without a hitch. And then it's part of the custodial time for the setup and the tear down of the ceremony. And that one doesn't even, I mean, if you really wanted, if you wanted a true cost center, I mean, you would take into all the assistant administrative time for setting the whole graduation up and collecting fees and doing the programs and sorting everything out and filing the shirts, and none of that is costed in here.
And we don't see that. $45, I should know this since I paid it last year, $45?
Yes, correct.
Okay.
Yes.
Again, I think we need to take baby steps. I think the administration's done a very good job. We've, with athletics, look what we've done. We let people in free to all athletics except football and hockey and stuff. You know, we're looking at live streaming it. There's no cost technically to the taxpayers in Addison, built in with the referendum and everything else. I guess the only thing I would just keep looking at is just you do a great job minimizing that dollar amount. Keep it where it's at if we can. Keep it. Because I think people are used to paying fees. You know, if we can save money on it, I know that's what you're looking at. Mm-hmm. But I think if people actually go out there and see what the staff, the custodians actually do out there, it's a lot of work. And they put a lot of extra time into setting stuff up, making sure everything is standing up so the wind doesn't blow it down, et cetera, et cetera. So, I mean, the $45 is, to me, is a minimal fee for what we're getting out of this. If we can maintain that, I think it'd be great.
And just so you know, we couldn't, the furthest we could go back, it's been $45. So when the board originally approved it, it was $45, and we haven't changed it since then. So it's been a long time that it's been $45.
I have a question, really. What you had said kind of got me going on a train. It's for Jason. When this ceremony fee, graduation fee, whatever you want to call it, is communicated to the families, is there a list of what it goes towards? Because I think if we provide that up front.
Not a specific list because it covers so many different things. So it goes out in our graduation handbook, which is part of the mailing costs that go out. So I can't remember when it goes out, December, January, something like that, that kind of lists out some of the main pieces and deadlines and things like that that take place. But it doesn't list out, because to be honest with you, you take a look at the list that's here, to Jane's point, it doesn't encompass everything. And maybe we need to do a better job of talking the big things, but there's just a lot of those other pieces that aren't in there, aren't even, you know, costed out. So no, we don't. When people have asked me about it, mm-hmm. Usually what I've done is I've explained to them or try to do my best to explain to them the costs involved. And I think when they get that, those people that have the questions step back and say, okay, yeah, that makes sense, sort of a thing. So, and I try to use the idea too of what it costs to be outside versus inside and stuff. And to Steve's question, you know, this year, if we were inside, we could still give six tickets. I don't think we'll be able to do that next year. I don't know if it's five, it's four. I'd have to sit down with Mike Toohey and re-kind of calculate things and stuff like that. But I knew he was concerned, our lead custodian, once we got over 500, of the amount of people and things like that that we would be able to do. And I think another point that when a lot of the feedback I've gotten from people is, you know, you start to get to that point of how many tickets and stuff can you give? Do you want to stay on campus? You know, do you do what some other schools do and you rent out those pieces? And there's a fairly large expense that goes with that too, and some of the things that you would be responsible for, even though you're renting out the venue and things like that. And the feedback, again, I've gotten just from talking to people is they like being on campus. You know, they like being able, if you're inside, to still be able to maybe take some pictures and things like that. Obviously, if we get big enough where we have to start to make that decision, we would get feedback from community and family and things like that. But my sense is people want to stay here.
I think we do a great job to adjusting to what's going on. I mean, we got the golf carts out the last couple of years to take people around. I know I'm sure it was probably more than what you have up there because there was people running everywhere doing that, and that was an extra value that you don't really think of a cost to put up there.
And the interesting thing about being outside is, you know, up until like the last 3 years, we were not outside for like a long time. And so when we did the first one, we learned a lot, and we've been fortunate enough to be outside multiple times since then. So,
Mr. Chair,
yeah,
a couple more questions. There's the fee here for live streaming. Will that be not included because of the equipment we're purchasing that we talked about in the previous discussion, or is it different because it's large scale?
We rented that this year.
Okay.
So we wanted to be able to live stream, so we worked with Jerry Cooper and Randy Mathis and Mark Tauchi to figure out what we needed, and they rented some of that equipment.
Just trying to process some of this piece. I like what Steve was saying about we're doing everything we can to kind of keep the expenses cost. Also looking in terms of knowing forward, but at least by that ninth grade class, we're going to have to make some possible changes with how we do graduation, whether it's a venue change or whatever the piece is there. We had talked about whatever, if we are going to make any changes in the past, that we would put together some sort of a parent-student committee to go forward. I would like to see something like that started sooner than later as we're looking at that, and as we're and have part of the discussion, the fees, as well as the venues and how that would change. Honestly, if there is a way that we could trim a few things on this a little bit tighter and take the cost away from the parents for that final culmination of their academic career in the district, I'd be all in favor of it, because I think it's something that we should be able to cover in our budget and something that we should plan forward to. Yet, I understand that we might have a venue change and that might change the cost of the ceremony. I think we should start looking at what we can do, because I think we should cover it personally.
I guess one other suggestion I would have is, I get nervous, you know, being on so many different youth boards when we would itemize stuff, and boy, if we forgot something or mislabeled something, I would be a little weary to try to itemize every little caveat out there to send to seniors. I think it's more about a discussion with parents. Like, I don't think a lot of parents knew that, you know, Jason, if you're only using two tickets, can I have your other two tickets? You know, I don't think parents get that. And I think maybe what we do is look at just communicating a little differently and a little bit better on that. Because I'd be just a little nervous about, you know, somebody looking at, oh, pizza, well, why do we need pizza? My God, it's only $371. It goes to a great cause for the kids. You know, I don't want somebody sitting there questioning, nickel and diming that either, mm-hmm. what you guys are doing. Because the kids love it. The kids enjoy it. You know, maybe we rephrase it to your point on that. So that's my thoughts on that.
Any other questions, comments, concerns?
Mr. Chair, just to go back, because somebody did at one point kind of look at how much it costs to go off-site, right? And was it comparable, or was it a little more? I can't remember.
Yeah, we didn't look at total costs. We looked at some venue costs.
Okay.
You know, so just getting the venue itself was, you know, anywhere from $10,000 to $13,000. So that doesn't totally take care of all of these other things. Plus, it adds more logistics and other expenses that are just different.
Right.
You know, transportation, parking, all of those things. So it wasn't an apples to apples comparison, but we knew it would cost us $10,000 to $13,000 to get an off-site venue.
Yeah, and a lot of those places, you have to provide your own sound. You have to provide a lot of the other things, too, that we're already doing. So not only do you have to get the site, bus the kids up there, and then you have to bring all that other stuff, too. So
I guess I feel, my personal feeling is I would like us to make more of a commitment to keep it on site and to do what it takes to make that happen than I am about the individual fee, maybe. Just because I think the value that brings to students who are graduating and just having that last time on campus, I think that's more valuable in my mind. But that's probably not even this discussion. So.
And I think, I mean, we did make the comment the first time we talked about this that we would form a committee of parents, administrators, students, to talk about those kind of things. So I think that'd be something nice to do, like you said, sooner rather than later.
But, yeah.
You know, seeing on the horizon that, you know, we're 3 years away from that huge class. But I think that we've got some steps moving forward to create that committee and do that communication. And
I'm sorry, I need clarification on what the function of the committee is. Is it when we first have, what did you say, our junior class is the class where we have to talk about the four tickets, maybe?
No,
this year.
Yeah, the junior class, yeah.
The junior class, yeah. The current junior class. Is it to start with that class and start talking about the fact that we have, it's a potential four tickets if we're not outside? What would be the function of this committee that you're suggesting?
If I recall, when we originally had that conversation, it was just a committee to start talking about those emergency type of situations, whether we have to go off campus or we have to limit tickets or remember what else.
I feel like it was more about bringing the community together to kind of decide what do we want to do going forward.
So
we're
reaching
a point where we're going to have this issue
of graduation.
Right. Yep. So it's for the junior year coming up, but for going forward, I think.
So a decision-making committee about venue, cost, What other kinds of decisions would you like to see from that committee?
I'd say venue costs, what is the appetite for dropping the number of tickets down? Steve, your family might be the normal, or you might be the 5% that says it's super important to us. See what the feeling is of the whole high school committee of
so it would
tickets.
Be, I'm sorry, I'm just going to clarify again. Is the point of the committee then to really kind of prioritize the different components so that a decision can be made by administration whether or not it should be on campus or off campus? Like all those different, is that what we're looking for? Some kind of decision-making matrix as a result of this committee?
I would say yes.
I think when the discussion happened, it was specifically about off-campus versus staying on campus.
Yeah.
I thought that was specifically what we were talking about.
The core of it, but I think all these other factors play into it.
I mean, the kids don't have, I mean, the cost is going to be there. I know you're probably saying fee more is what you're saying.
Yeah, I'm just trying to look for some direction for that. To assemble the committee, I wouldn't want a committee to be assembled to have a conversation with no... And
purpose.
You are expecting an outcome, and I'd like to clarify what that outcome would be as a result of having this committee. That's all I'm trying to.
I guess it would be, to me, it'd be off campus or on campus, because I think if we're going live stream, and I even hate to say this because the classes are getting so big, we would have to pull it from the stadium, because I wouldn't want us to sit there and say, well, it's 3 days before, and then we have to get everybody out there to put more chairs out when we could have it inside with the live stream. Because there would be significant savings on that alone instead of setting outside, I would imagine, as well, wouldn't you, Jane? So if we didn't have to plan the next couple of years, it's either going to be off-site at wherever or on campus at Farmington.
I don't think we can do that. I think if whoever it is decides that we are going to be off-site, we're off-site.
Mm-hmm.
I think you have to book those venues out
that
ahead of time, and once you're locked into doing that. So I think the decision, the conversation would have to center around, do we value that in getting as many tickets as you want, or do we value staying on campus knowing that right now you get six, it's probably going to be four, and I'm making numbers up, so you got to forgive me. It's going to be four, and it might be two at one point in time and things like that. Because if you look at the schools in 196, that's kind of the progression that they've gone through. Mm-hmm. When they can, they have it outside. When they can't, they have it inside. And obviously their gyms are much smaller than ours. So I want to say that they get two tickets inside and then another two to their auditorium, something like that. But they've made that decision to stay on campus. And ultimately, I think that's the decision that kind of needs to be made, because once you decide that we're going to stay on campus, then it's a mathematical formula how many people you can fit in the gym.
Yep.
And you can just simply divide and figure out how many tickets are going to be available based on that.
Yep. Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
I actually called, because I knew we were going to be discussing this, I called all of the high schools in our South Suburban Conference and talked to them about graduation fees. And Lakeville North specifically, they have an off-site graduation, but they get two tickets. And then any guest after that has to pay for their own ticket. So that's another option. That's a potential that could happen as well. So, you're talking about a ceremony fee, and then your guests are going to have to pay a fee too, potentially, depending on where offsite things are, on top of parking, things like that. So there's just a lot of variables to consider. So
I think the only school that doesn't charge, I mean, there isn't anything associated, I think, is Prior Lake in our discussions. I think Prior Lake is the only one. They do it on campus, and I don't think there's anything. I think everybody else has some sort of cost, whether it's a graduation fee or like Lakeville North and South do, you get two tickets and then you can have everybody else, and then it's $8 a ticket after that. There's something associated with that.
Any other?
I'm a little concerned, and Barb's questions have made me really question the committee thing, because and it's not that I don't want to get input, because I think we should get input. I'm just wondering if we can do it differently than that. Like, do we need to really form a committee, or could we do a survey, or could we do a... It just feels like, how many times are we going to meet? And, and then, are you really going to get people showing up? I don't know. I feel like the committee word is a little red flaggish for me.
Mr. Chair.
Yes.
Could this be a focus group? We have a,
I mean, that's different than a committee. It's terminology here. But could there just be a couple of meetings if people come for input and then as well have a survey as well? There's just something, maybe not like a formal committee, but like, this is what we're looking at. This is what the board's talking about. This is the future. What are your thoughts? How, you know, that, and then just kind of take input from that. Would that be a little bit of a different structure? I mean, it's terminology to an extent, but.
For sure. Didn't we do something with that? I want to say in January when we were talking about the budget, we had like certain board members go to one school and two people go to the other, and then we had kind of just a discussion where the public could come. Correct me if I'm wrong.
I ran with into you, but you now that I'm
night.
Not.
I can't remember if it was the budget.
Had
or
a budget. Oh. We had a budget community meeting
community
at the
meeting,
high school.
So we could do something like that where a couple board members go one spot just so people can come and give us input. I don't think making a committee, like
I think
Kristen said.
Asking people to come is you're not going to get the people there. That's my opinion on it. And I feel like from my perspective as a parent, I probably wouldn't be able to take the time to go to a focus meeting, but I would like to be able to give my input. So how can we provide a venue where they can give input, but maybe not have to actually physically go to another meeting,
or
another location?
An emailed survey of some kind? Or
so then could I ask that question again then? So if we did a survey then, I would put together a survey for you that says the board is looking for input on, you know, various options for graduation and look for some kind of prioritization of different elements so that you could, so on-site versus off-site, you know, some kind of question about, you know, number of people needing to, you know, like something, I don't know because I haven't put, this is on the fly, but something along those lines to try and get what are the questions that you have that you want information about in terms of what's important to people and then bring that back to you for your future discussion about things.
Yeah, I
is
I
that
think that'd be fair.
Does that cost money to do one of those? I know the other surveys do, but
well, this
like,
is not a highly scientific
right.
survey.
So it shouldn't, right? That's
so
what
when
I'm,
I
whenever
I
assume that
it's like I would call this more like a feedback form,
I would, like a Survey Monkey or something.
Yeah, that's okay. What I'm suggesting.
That's
I'm not,
what I was going.
It's a good question because I am a stickler for that, and so it is. Not, I would call this more feedback than scientific survey. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I would think we would want to know, would you like to be on campus or off?
Mm-hmm.
How many tickets would your family like? And is paying a fee of $45 something that you, just to get an overall, this is what the community is saying as a whole.
I think, how many tickets would your family like and what's the minimum number of tickets?
Yeah,
and also
somebody,
would you be willing to pay for additional tickets?
Right.
Because that's...
Can I make a suggestion? Why don't we come up with the questions and give them to you, and then we can give them to Barb. We'll come up with like maybe four or five questions.
That's fair.
Yeah, if you have any additional ideas.
Email them to Jake,
Barb,
and then we
send
can
them to me, Barb.
Proof them and see what you think. It's the administration's opinion.
Mm-hmm. Maybe end of the week, if you have any additional questions, have them sent to me. So I can give them to
and
Barb.
If you just put them in the form of, I would like to know what people think about, I can figure out all the rest, but if you just tell me what you need to know, and then we can go from
that's
there.
Mm-hmm.
And I would love to see it sent to the kids too, the students.
Mm-hmm.
Right, kids, they're not kids. They're
Mr. Chair, are we emailing you those, or are we emailing them to Barb?
You can email them to me, and I'll send them to Barb. Just in while better.
You'll compile.
Yeah, I was just gonna add. Maybe it was something we could do during like a scheduled time during the day where we could have an open discussion with maybe just the senior class this year or the senior class and the junior class, bring them into the recital hall, maybe during like a ramp time sometime soon or an academic support time where we could get student feedback from that too, because I know that a lot of the students can relay messages from their parents too. I mean, we're graduating, starting the rest of our lives real soon, so if we can't relay those messages from our parents, it's kind of a problem. But I think if we get the students involved and get their opinions too, a lot of people would be happy about that.
I think that's a good point too.
Mr. Chair, also talking about that target audience, I think we need to make sure we're focusing on even like the eighth graders, that eighth grade class too. The classes continually get larger, correct? Is that about, or is it just that the ninth grade's a larger class? Just in terms of like, once high school gets rolling, we're moving fast. It'd be nice for, even though
those eighth grade families may think, oh my gosh, that's so far away. I think we just put it on the radar as well.
I guess that raises a question for me. Wouldn't it be sent to all parents?
Oh, that's a good question. Yeah. What's the target audience is a worth question asking too. Then that's a good point.
Personally, I wouldn't go past the freshmen. I don't think anyone needs to worry about it unless you have kids graduating in the next 2 or 3 years. That's just me though.
Yeah, I guess I don't know.
Does that change your job with that? I mean,
No, that wouldn't, only if I had a lot of open-ended questions and if I kept it to no open-ended questions, because you're just seeking feedback.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so that's no problem as long as it's easily.
I mean, if you don't care calculable. About it because you have a first grader, you're not going to respond.
That's
good point.
So does it matter if it goes to everybody? I guess I feel like it's important all parents to have the ability to give input. But
no, I think
for students though, maybe it makes sense to limit it to high school.
Yes, I would agree.
No, Mr. Chair, that's a valid question. I think we all maybe were thinking a different scope of where it was going, because I think I was originally thinking high school and then maybe a little beyond. And no, I think all makes perfect sense.
So action steps, send me your questions by the end of the week. I will send them to Barb. She'll do her Barb thing and write the questions.
Smoke, mirrors. Mm-hmm. And then we'll connect with Taylor too about what the student input piece would look like. Okay.
All right. Mm-hmm. Sounds good. Thank you, Jane, Jason, Barb, Jane. Mm-hmm. Next up, we have administrative action, two items under that. First is the approval of the 17-19 paraprofessional contract with Ms. Mary Ann Thomas.
Good evening, Chair Cordes, members of the board, members of the community, and Superintendent Hogan. I'm happy to present to you the paraprofessional contract for the 17-19 contract period. So it's a two-year contract, and it is within the financial parameters of the board set. There's a couple interesting things that we did with this contract that I think are going to be very helpful to us. One of the things we did was freeze the longevity pay for 2 years and diverted that money to the base salary. You may recall that our paraprofessionals, one of the things we've had trouble with is competing with neighboring school districts, and this is going to help us elevate that base pay a little bit and maybe be more attractive for new employees to come into the school district. So I was pretty glad that we came together on that. That aspect of their base pay. We also eliminated two of the health insurance options for our paraprofessional employees. Now they will only be available or able to participate in the deductible plan. And for that, we did add a $250 contribution to the health savings account. That would go into effect July 1, 2018. And for the vast, vast majority of our paraprofessionals, it actually is financially better for them. They'll either break even or be accumulating more money in their health savings account. So it takes a bit of education, which both sides are committed to doing, and we already have started doing to let our paraprofessional employees. It's a lot easier than when there were educational assistants. Anyway, educating them and how the deductible plan works and how it can benefit them and their families. We did add a small contribution to their 403B plan, the matching plan, and we added language where we're going to have a committee get together as needed throughout the year to talk about different workplace issues. So we don't have to hold them all up until negotiations. We can talk about different issues that come up and bring the parties that, you know, the directors or the principals that need to be there on a periodic basis throughout the school year. I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have. Otherwise, you have the resolution before you to approve the 17-19 contract.
Are there any questions? Hearing none, I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion to approve the collective bargaining agreement between the International Union of Operating Engineers, Local Number 70, representing paraprofessionals for the contract period of July 1, 2017 through June 30th, 2019, as presented.
Second.
Got a motion by Doyle, a second by Goodrow. A roll call vote, please.
Carraro?
Yes.
Doyle?
Yes.
Goodrow?
Yes.
Sasser?
Yes.
Cordes?
Yes. Motion passes. Thank you, Marianne. Next up, we have the approval of security camera bid pack with Ms. Jane Huska.
Mr. Chair, board members, Superintendent Haugen, and members of the community, it's going to be kind of a team effort tonight. I'm going to go through the budget, and then we'll have Brandon from Ellert come up to go through the process, and Nate will also be up here to answer any questions for this project. As you recall, our security project, we came back to you earlier this year to ask for an additional funds for this so we could have a good baseline for all of our schools. And the board approved roughly $506,000 for our security. And we have been putting different things in our schools already. We've done some cabling. We're working on some servers. We brought that stuff to the board. So the one of the last pieces to this project is the physical cameras to install in our building. And we went through our request for proposal process instead of a bid process. And Brandon from Ellert will go through the difference there. And hopefully during the end of this conversation, we'll be able to have the board approve a $215,000 package from ProTech. So Brandon will come up.
Good evening. So, introduce myself. My name is Brandon Fraser with Ellert Associates. I am our senior technology and security consultant. We're an independent security and technology consulting firm. So, I've been working with Farmington ISD for a very long time. I have stepped in to help Felix Feingersch, who has been working with Farmington long before I was at Ellert Associates. So, long history with you guys. We were hired to go through the entire design process, and then through nearing the end of design, we discussed doing an RFP versus an RFB. So the differences is on a request for bid, it's typically just a low bid win situation. You have a bid form, they put a price, that's what you see, that's what you award off of. You really don't know anything about the company, anything about what they're proposing, what they're doing. You just look at that final number. Where a request for a proposal, it's a bid package. So information about the company, their certified technicians, we have minimum requirements in there for project experience, certifications. You can see a lot of criteria that we have in there. And it allows us to look at the company that we're gonna award to, that make sure that they're qualified to do that, and not just a rounding error that causes us to award a contract to someone who really isn't qualified or simply doesn't have the manpower to do a project of this size. So does that make sense to answer some of your questions?
Yeah, just so when we do an RFB, the request for a bid, isn't it legal, aren't we legally required to pick the lowest bid? Is that correct?
On an RFB, yes, you are legally required to pick what we call the lowest responsible bid.
Got it. Well, that definition answers my questions for future. Thank you.
Sure. Yep. So
I have one more question about that, Mr. Chair. Is on that, can't you set specific parameters and guidelines that they have to meet before submitting
the bid
as well, correct?
You can. Yeah, you can. It's very difficult to tell. You know, we can have them submit their certifications as part of that bid, but it's difficult to evaluate the strengths or weaknesses of any company. You know, a lot of people can meet those minimum check boxes, but it's hard to actually do an evaluation.
Okay. Thank you.
Yep. So, do you want me to describe a little more of the process we went through? So, we collected all of our bids. We got five very good bids. So, we had one that was very low, one that was very high, and then we had three grouped tightly in the middle within a 2% spread, which is extremely good. It shows that we have some very consistent criteria, very consistent bids. So went through an evaluation. You can see how we scored each one of these. In the end, because of ProTech's prior experience with the district, the number of qualified technicians, the size of the projects that they do, they scored above everybody else. So the lowest bid, who was very low, their primary specialty is actually door hardware. They're a door hardware company. That's what their primary specialty is. They have been getting into the security side of it. But their references were not very good. Not that they were bad, they were smaller projects. They only had two of them. This would have been by far and their largest project. And only had seven certified technicians. So had we awarded this project to them and they get another sizable project, they simply would not have had enough technicians to work on this. So this would have had to have been their sole and only project, in our opinion, to be able to keep, you know, without getting over or too busy for the seven technicians that they had on staff.
Mr. Chair, in regards to that, when they're during this process, is there a set timeline that we are asking to get the job done, or as part of the proposal, how long would it take them to complete the job?
Yep, so we gave some rough criteria when we wanted the job completed before the 2018, but they were allowed, and again, it was part of the criteria is to give us a schedule that they're comfortable with. That doesn't exceed the timeline, mm-hmm. but certainly if they believe they can get it done quicker, then that just weighs a little more in their favor.
Any other questions? Good. I have, yeah. Contractually, do we have incentives based on time frame, or is it okay? We don't have anything.
Yeah,
like
we had no incentives for the time frame. We also had no liquidated damages if they were to go past a time frame.
Okay. How about like warranty after they will they keep coming out for a year after they installed it, or for how long to
yep,
fix
so
stuff?
So at the end of the project completion, when we call it final complete, so we have a substantial completion. That's when you're mostly functional. There's a period where we'll do inspections. When it's what we call final completion, 100% complete, issue their final payment, that enters into a one-year warranty. So it'll be a one-year end-to-end warranty. Any equipment failure, any problem from installation, that's all covered at no cost to the district.
Service calls and all that?
Everything.
Everything,
yep.
Okay.
Yep. Now, obviously, outside of acts of God, vandalism, things like that. But right. Yeah, if there's any failure, any issue, that's all covered
okay.
within the first year.
Mr. Chair,
yep.
Is there any reason from your assessment of this why the TCH group has a significantly lower bid than the others? And the others all within the same range. I understand what you're saying, experience and less employees, maybe less overhead. Is that what it is? Or
a
I mean, what
bit.
Are your thoughts?
I can speculate a little bit. I've been in this industry for a long time, and I've worked with all these companies. They have a lower labor rate. So their technicians, they had just had a lower labor rate by close to $20 an hour. I'm pretty sure that they didn't really mark up the equipment. So they're basically reselling the hardware of close to what they buy it for. So I think their margins are significantly lower. And that's what kind of resulted in that close to $30,000 difference between the other integrators. That scares me a lot. I don't like when contracts don't have any margin there, because there needs to be some give and take, especially on a project where these are existing buildings. You run into, you know, you're opening ceiling tiles, you run into things you didn't expect. You know, we of course didn't open every ceiling tile in the design. So there has to be a little flexibility. If they don't have any margin, then you start seeing change orders for every little tiny thing that was outside of their expectation.
I appreciate it. I understand you had this evaluation process, but it's hard to look at the numbers and go, well, why is this one so significantly lower, even though I see your rating and scoring? I'm just trying to understand. So.
Yep. And that's what it was. And we did take a very hard look at Twin City Hardware. And if this was if it was an entire district-wide project, we'd have a little more comfort. But it's a big install at a lot of schools. Not an extremely tight time frame, but a fairly tight time frame that we just didn't believe that seven people as a total company size could get it done.
I appreciate how you broke stuff down, though, points and stuff like that. It's pretty intricate to
yep,
see.
Yep, and
so.
this exact process we've gone through on many, many projects.
Oh. ProTech's the only company that has experience with the district?
What? Yeah, so Parsons Technologies purchased a company called All Systems. All Systems had some experience with the district. It was, I don't know if I'd say it was a negative experience. It was a very...
Maybe not as positive as ProTech. Not to put it nicely.
Let's put it very neutral. So I knew that although they're All Systems, a Parsons company, it was really All Systems who put together the bid under the Parsons name. It was the same people that the district hadn't had great experience with it, because they were only, I think it was something like $2,000 lower than ProTech. You know, that just put them underneath. We scored them a little less on the past experience.
And Quick follow-up. What project did ProTech work on before, or projects? Do you know?
For the district?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you might know.
ProTech helped us with the high school cameras, convert all of ours. We were on ONSSI, convert us over to the milestone, which we're going to go forward with all the cameras.
Okay.
Did everyone understand what Nate just said?
No,
we do this a lot.
Just smile and nod.
Yeah.
We were using a software to view the cameras that was the brand was ONSSI, and we had an opportunity when those two companies, they had like a split, that we could choose to stay with ONSSI, the license we purchased, or go with Milestone. And we chose to go with Milestone because we were told that it was better software and some compatibility. Sorry about that. Did that help?
Mr. Chair,
yep.
What are we looking at on a time frame for starting then, obviously pending approval? How quickly, is this something that can be done through the winter, or is this not till spring, or?
Very soon, almost as soon as we can. So if you guys approve it, we will get contracts put together. It takes about a week, we'll get contracts sent over to ProTech, pending any feedback or anything that comes back from them that delays that a little bit. Once that contract is signed, they're free to move forward. So the step right after contracts is they put together submittals. They submit that to us for approval. Once we approve the submittals, that's our entire design, everything they're using, almost reiterates what we did. They're free to purchase equipment and move forward with the installation. That typically takes somewhere between 1 to 4 weeks between contract signing and submittals complete.
Will they be working off hours in the buildings or?
No.
Okay.
They'll be working during hours. Yep.
Any other questions?
Just logistically, will they be like one school at a time, or do they have, or is it a large enough operation that they'll be in multiple schools at one time? Or don't we know? Or maybe it doesn't matter. I'm just curious.
I don't know yet. I suspect they're going to put together a single team, and they're going to be working one school at a time. The cable is getting pulled by a different contractor, so it's going to be waiting for them.
Okay.
So they're basically going to take the cable down, plug the device in, hang it, move on to the next one. So I think they're going to go one school at a time.
Mr. Chair, just to clarify in the historical piece of this, this is the system we've been talking about for a long time. This is just the final piece, right? Okay, just because sometimes we talk about things and then we bring them back and I get confused, is this something different? And just want to clarify where we're at. If you could just mention that timeline a little bit, Jane. Just
yeah, to... well, this is the last piece of the puzzle.
Yeah.
You know, so we've come to you, you know, for the approval of the additional funds. We came back with the cabling. We've bought some servers and licensure. And so the cameras are the last piece to the puzzle to get the product up and running, because we've had conversations about Milestone that Nate talked about, yep, making sure that the city can dial in on it and whatnot. So, yep, last piece of the puzzle.
Thank you. Just helps to clarify.
Yep.
All right. If there are no more questions, I will take a motion.
I'll make a motion to award the contract for security cameras to ProTech Design as presented.
Second.
Got a motion by Carraro, a second by Goodrow. Roll call vote, please.
Carraro?
Yes.
Doyle?
Yes.
Goodrow?
Yes.
Saucer?
Yes.
Cordes?
Yes. Motion passes. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
All right. That brings us to the end of the agenda, so I will take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Got a motion by Saucer, a second by Doyle. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Those opposed? We're adjourned.